get our business done.
Yeah. So some housekeeping. Thank you, everyone who's engaged with this challenging text. We conclude our study discussion of the Church Cracked Open today. And there's going to be a survey going out to the parish, just three questions that Jared and I will formulate, and Sarah Dahl will help to administrate, to listen to the parish. Last week, we talked about how we could collectively and individually think about how to creatively practice what we've been learning in this text within our context. So that should go out, I hope, in the next couple of weeks to the whole parish. Based on the data that we receive from listening to the people of St. John's, we will then think about programming in the summer and programming in the fall, again, that are grounded in the four priorities that have been set for our diocese: discipleship, faithful innovation, justice, and vitality. So keep an eye out for a survey that'll come out in the next couple of weeks. And then next week, I'm delighted that Jared and I have curated a series on Audio Divina. We've selected music that breaks open the Holy Scriptures appointed for the Sundays in Lent. And knowing that both Jared and I have very eclectic and very different tastes in music, we've got quite a lot of music that I hope will connect with everyone's tastes in the parish. So join us, that begins next Sunday, the first Sunday in Lent, Audio Divina. We will send out the scriptures ahead of time with the four tracks that Jared and I have selected. Read and listen to the music ahead of time and then come to the discussion prepared on Sundays. So that's the housekeeping.
All right. Well then, great. Welcome everyone. I thought the prayer that Stephanie leaves us with at the end of the book is something that maybe would be appropriate for us to use as our opening prayer. It starts on page 134. Let us pray. Let our jars be cracked open. Let our lives be poured out. Let our lives witness to those virtues and vows and gospel truth, knowing that all we do and think and say and pray matter. Crack it a little further every single day and let the light, the right, the repentance join hearts in the wisdom and life prepared for cracked hearts from all eternity. Amen.
Amen.
Well, what I start to, again, just give a short summary of where I was with this book and this last chapter, as well as, you know, just to start some of the conversation. I've really appreciated it over the last, several weeks. It's been, sometimes difficult, some chair squirming, wriggling, but also a deep understanding of our own history of our church. And I was just talking on Friday with a woman from Massachusetts who is Episcopalian, and in her church, of course, out in the East Coast, there are many cradle to grave Episcopalians, and they were reading this book as well. And there was a little more chair wriggling, in her congregation as they read this book. But it sort of made me, capturing this whole thing. And what I really love about this last chapter is it's coming back around to where we started in the fall. Perfect landing of the plane, as they say in storytelling, that we come back to where we started. The story starts, or this book starts, with this story of the woman at Simon the Leper's helm with Jesus, and really, let's just say, smashing something on the table and basically with this statement of things have to be different. Not that things are going to be different and things have to be different going forward. And I think that, it kind of reminded me, there's that same scene has been captured so many times in movies where the nuclear family is at the dinner table and everyone's talking and, there's been this bubbling scene or this bubbling problem. And finally, one of the people in the nuclear family just screams or smashes a glass or something and just says, ah, and then people go, oh, I get kind of, you know, shocked out of it. And I think what I see in this book is just that, that we've had these tremendous disruptions, these shocks, these smashed glasses on the table or alabaster jars. And, you know, the movie's got to change direction from that point on. We have to, we use that moment, if you will, to do something different. And maybe, you know, maybe this, I don't mean to dismiss the core theme of this major disruption of this racial reckoning that is the second one, but there will be other disruptions. There will be other major forces that are going to, you know, impact our community, impact the world, maybe even closely impact our lives here. You know, we have these other disruptive forces, you know, addiction, you know, the Me Too disruption, that social reckoning, if you will, the 1%, which was permeating through our country, you know, several years ago. And I hate to say even worse, the mental health of our youth, and the addictions that sometimes follow, or and that has struck very close to this parish. In fact, embedded in this parish, with, you know, the death of Cooper Olson. So I think, you know, there are going to be other disruptions, and I don't mean to dismiss a major piece of this book around racial reckoning, but we have to, what we've heard in this last chapter, that it comes back to this practice of discipleship, of moving forward daily to create this community. And just to close my sort of opening thoughts, that, you know, a lot of people have asked me, well, you know, Don, how did your college, you know, or, you know, School of Engineering at St. Thomas thrive in this disruption of the pandemic where everything got turned upside down? And my standard response to that is, you know, people are gonna say, well, we started this communication plan and da-da-da, you know, and then we had this, and we had the students do this, we had the teacher, all strategic tactical stuff. But I say every time when someone asks me that, the success of our thriving in this last disruption started 10 years ago with the culture that we set for ourselves. Mm-hmm. And it is a daily practice, if you will. It's something that can't blow in the wind you know, with the changes in the currents. And so if you do, I've learned this, you know, firsthand, that if you focus on cultural practice of daily practice and core questions that guide what you do, your organization is able to thrive with these major disruptions. And again, I know that we've spent a lot of time about racial reckoning, but I think that there are also other major disruptions that, you know, we will face, that are looming and we have faced. And I hope that what we do gain from these difficult conversations is that practice and pattern of life of discipleship that will allow us to not thrive necessarily, but certainly survive those disruptions going forward. What did others either take generally from the book now that we're coming to a close, or this last chapter, or maybe, yeah, just reflections on what you've taken away so far? Barbara, you're making notes.
I'm just thinking about
Holly.
Yay. Well, I appreciate you opening us up like that, Don, because I was thinking much the same about the book. I appreciate it very much, but I thought, you know, the brokenness, the cracks, mm-hmm. that are going to really be the impetus or the launch pad for many folks to move forward are going to be particular to the church or the situation or the community. I mean, it may or may not be focused on the disruption of race and power in that way. It may be a different kind of disruption. I don't know, but I really appreciate the fact that you kind of cracked it open for us to think about in that way. And the other thing I would say is that this image that she's given us all the way through the book of the crack, I think is another one that could take us in different directions and open up different ways of thinking about it, right? Because when I think of crack, it can be an opportunity. It can also be a grief. I mean, when I broke a plate the other day, I was sad. It was something my mother had given me, right? When I was watching on TV The Amazing Race the other day, they were breaking plates like this. I don't know if you saw this particular scene, but they did it out of frustration. It was an assignment. They had to break these plates in order to find the clue that was buried under one of the plates, right? But they were breaking them because they were so mad, because the last challenge that they had to do was to find something that they couldn't find underneath a rock. And I'm going, oh my God, how many can we make out of this, right? That the breaking of the plates is also an act of frustration and anger and taking it out. So I guess my point there, if there is one, is that, you know, the image that she gives us to think about also can be useful as we move forward to realizing that there are many ways in which that brokenness can open us up, or that we can think about it. So anyway, there you go.
I can't remember before, and if I did, forgive me, but I, all throughout this, I've been thinking about that line of Leonard Cohen, ring the bells that still can ring, forget your perfect offering. There is a crack in everything. That's how the light gets in. Yeah. Mm-hmm. And I think far too often we imagine that moving on the issue of race or gender or whatever it is, or all of these things at the same time, requires a kind of perfection before we can go anywhere. Mm-hmm. And a fear that if we don't get this perfectly right, we're going to embarrass ourselves, or we're going to do something wrong and people are going to yell at us, or we're going to, you know. And that line from Cohen has always struck me. Yeah, we're cracked, we're broken, and we want to come with a perfect offering, but we're not going to do that. Mm-hmm. Whatever offering we bring is going to be imperfect. It's going to be fragile. We're going to have to make mid-course corrections. But it's that crack that lets in the light. And if we will ourselves to insularity, we will ourselves to death. So I would encourage us all, as we move forward, to not have to have the perfect plan. Don, you talked about academia, and my life in academia and with faculty want a perfect, unambiguous plan that's going to work 100% of the time with no flaws. There's no such thing. And you have to move into it with a kind of vigorous willing to fall flat on your face and then stand up and get going again. So my encouragement, forget your perfect offer. Walk into the future with a kind of bold commitment to do what is right as disciples of Jesus with regard to these things. And if you fall and break a plate, okay, get up and get going again.
Greg or Mark?
Mark, go ahead.
Well, and to link that, thank you, Jay, for those thoughts. To link that with something that she does here as she turns to the way of love, right, in the chapter, and in her treatment of turn, she says something on page 122 that to my mind, we can talk about church being cracked, and there's that kind of negative set of connotations that come with that. There's new possibility and everything. But it seems to me that she's calling for a certain boldness on the part of the church, a certain flexibility, an ability to adapt to emerging situations. And she really drives home the stakes of not doing so on page 122. So it's in that second full paragraph, about three sentences in. She says, if your congregation or institution is terrified of change or being wrong, and this maybe connects to some of your point, Jay, how can you begin to turn from the lure of empire and establishment? Right, and so the idea would be that not only do we need to not be afraid of being wrong, but in terms of changing, but if in certain regards we don't change, we don't have the courage to move into change, we will simply replicate the status quo, which itself is so historically rooted in empire, that we will keep enacting these deeply problematic ways of being as a church, right? So we need to not be afraid of being wrong. And there's quite a bit at stake in taking a chance on being wrong, because not doing so simply perpetuates empire.
Good.
I think Jan and Brad may have something to offer. And then Jared. So Jan and Phil, Jan and Phil, and then Jared, and then I'll speak.
Thanks for helping with the monitoring there, Chris.
Okay. Go ahead, Jan.
Yes. So are we heard? Can you hear?
Brian? Yes.
Yeah. Okay, good. I feel like, and I can't quite find the full sentence, but the one that Mark referred to, I underlined as well. I think, you know, we started at least with what I think is kind of a mistaken impression that we needed something jarring and shocking and tragic and difficult and, you know, like the pandemic. I think what it's done for us has caused us to pause in a way that we haven't before. We have before, but most recently, and so what I feel that Stephanie is calling us to go back to the start and actually embrace what allows us to call ourselves Christians. So the kenosis part of it, the emptying, is not to say, I'm sorry that we did all this. We've been focused on empire almost the entire life of the church, going back to Constantine, to 312, I think is the year that's referred to. And so I think it's very it's a positive call. And she and you know, I've recalled Bishop Curry talking this way for a long, long time, and Dwight Shiley's book was one of the first ones that I read, that it's to recognize we really haven't heard God's call. And there's a method by which we can do it, and it's not meant to be destructive but to recognize what empire means, things that we have not thought about before, what it looks like to everybody else. And so it takes in a lot of the racism issues, the all inequity and injustice, I think, and it, you know, I think I was thinking about Crack of Dawn this morning. You know, to an opening, an opportunity to have awareness and maybe a fresh start that is not punitive or destructive in any way. It's opening and it's a wonderful opportunity to me. Thank you,
Jared.
Thank you. All of these comments are incredibly helpful. Can you hear me all right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, great. Phone microphone, different computer microphone, just making sure. So I had three separate small thoughts. One is that Craig and I just came from clergy conference with our bishop and colleagues, and the closing sermon our bishop shared vulnerably with us, being the first time he had been in the room with that many of his clergy in the diocese at one time. And in his closing Eucharist homily, he reflected on the fact that it was, you know, literally 20 minutes after his consecration, not quite literally, but just moments after he was consecrated that and or elected, that George Floyd was killed. And he said, I remember coming into the diocese thinking, how do I do being bishop for the first time as a new bishop in the middle of a pandemic? And then George Floyd was murdered. And he thought, I was literally terrified. He said, I didn't know how to do this. He said, I'm not adequate to the job of leading the church in the midst of this racial reckoning. And then he said, I started talking to some of you and I could see you were scared. And I thought, oh no, like we're all scared. And how are we going to do this? And he was able to bring it back around to the notion that it was in that sort of collective acknowledgement of our inadequacy that we were able to turn towards Christ, who will empower us by the Spirit to do the work necessary to sort of stay with it. So I think that's part the first is we're all daunted by this. White and black, young and old, gay and straight, the work is daunting. But we have each other broken vessels to do this work in a broken world. And I think Stephanie has hit that many times. Two is I was in a diocesan meeting not too long ago where we were talking about a very kind of dollars and cents issue that had nothing to do with anything other than dollars and cents. And knowing that we were reading this and that our bishop had called us to justice, I asked the group if there was a way in which, because we were going to be distributing dollars in a way that seemed equitable, was there a way we could read our job through the lens of racial justice? And a colleague very naively and I think well-intentioned said, well, this isn't a racial justice conversation. That's a conversation for over there, and pointed to the work of other committees and other groups. And I was reminded again that unless we constantly keep this in front of us, we will think of racial justice as one area of ministry or a silo of being, when in fact it inflects all that we do. And that is to recognize that injustice or oppression interlocks with every other kind of oppression. So if we're going to talk about gender justice or sexual justice, or we're going to talk about any other poverty or anything else, it all interlocks. And Stephanie has gestured to that too. And then the final thing I want to say is, because it is so interlocking and all encompassing, St. John's is not going to sort of have picked this up and then set it down. I mean, obviously faith formation moves tomorrow or next Sunday to music, but Craig and I have already begun to think about the music through the lens of racial justice. And so it won't be the theme of the talk, but it will be in our minds as we lead it. Our vestry will begin to think about moving into a new future. And as they meet on retreat, they'll be asking questions about how is racial justice an ongoing issue in the midst of all that we work on. So those are just three disparate, disconnected, but I think very interrelated pieces I wanted to offer to the room as well.
Thanks, Jared. Chris, did you want to?
Yeah, I loved what Stephanie Spellis writes on page 128, that list of practices. Mm-hmm. Love the face and voice of God in others. Celebrate the cultures, gifts, and lives of rejected groups. Mm. Care and carry each other's burdens. Embrace uncomfortable spaces and experiences. Surrender over-controlling behaviors. Risk making the first move, sharing your own stories and being wrong. Listen with love to the stories of people who do not share your privilege. Sacrifice possessions and resources for the sake of love. Share access to privileged spaces and relationships. I think these guiding practices are things we could concretely apply in our lives. And if we don't actually, thank you, Don, for saying that this is a daily choice, daily discipline. This is a daily decision to be formed as followers in the way of love. And I think we can actually do these things.
Yeah.
Others in the room are in virtual space.
I think maybe the challenge is looking at this and seeing how all these things are related, there is perhaps a feeling of, oh my God, well, how can we do this? Because everything is tied to everything else. I think the important thing is to pick some area that we want to start with or work on and focus on that in the knowledge that these are interrelated, but not to be fearful of the fact that we can't work on everything at once. And I think that will give us a chance to have success.
I don't quite agree.
That's not unusual.
It makes life interesting and makes us feel alive too, I think. But to have a template, every decision that's made, whether it's altar flowers, whether it's the liturgy, whether it's what saints days are observed, what's the music. I'm hoping what might come out of this for starters is a template that requires any of us serving in any capacity at the church is required to look at. Are we consistent? Because that list that Craig read from is a summary, an abbreviation of that larger grid at pages 114 and 115 that Stephanie set out. And I think that would be helpful to do that. It reminds us.
Other thoughts that...
Sit down, here, sit.
Go up and chase it.
So, if you wouldn't mind muting, then the audio would be corrupted. Thank you.
And the puppy won't.
We were just joined by a lively puppy.
In the back, do you have some thoughts to share, or?
Not yet.
Okay. Otto. How about yourself? What are you thinking these days here, in these minutes and hours?
114, I think the chart that Jan brought up, the one that I focused on is listen with love to the stories of people who are oppressed. What do we do as a church to actually listen rather than telling them what we can do to help them? What do we do to listen?
In each one of these, really, of this template. I think we could find our weaknesses.
And the other thought, since it's quiet, fill the void, is can we learn to embrace our past, whether it's personal past, the church past, the Christian past, and say, okay, what good came out of this without beating ourselves up? Because it's hard to move forward if you're damaging yourself or hurting yourself when you're moving forward. So, you know what, let's take a look at the good things. And the liturgy is part of that. Our traditions are part of that. Embracing the faith form that we did by looking back at the church history book was part of that. I think you can move forward in a state of grace saying, you know, there were mistakes, which fits what was said before. Acknowledge the mistakes, acknowledge the hurt that may have been caused, and then in a state of grace say, you know, but there were good things and let's keep moving.
Right. Imperfectly.
Yeah.
Thing. Was that If It Be Your Will? Was that the song?
It's called Anthem.
Okay.
Good. Yeah.
You know, I think, and again, the chart and the summary chart that Craig just read are full of those. And I think you're right, Otto. The listening is also, that opening of oneself to receiving something new or hearing something new. And I think another theme that I think is permeated through a lot of our conversations is that opening yourself, vulnerability, imperfection, being comfortable being uncomfortable. But I think also listening is pausing and hearing other stories. And if we're gonna be a bigger church, a more inclusive church with our open door, then I think listening is put it to the top of the chart here. Barbara.
Who congregationally, collectively, who is the other for us that we are called to bring, to listen to bring in, or whatever? Who do we think the other is, or who or what is that?
One of the things that I wrote at the beginning or in my margins was, what is that measure of difference in our church? And, you know, one of the things I struggle with is every one of us leaves here and has 6 days of dealing. And we come to the sanctuary to be engaged and listen and amazing service. We come here for our, maybe ourselves. And so I for our own retreats, and I wonder, you know, I totally agree with you, Barbara. Who is that other? And maybe it's the person at the end of the pew. How much connection do we really have? We are coming into the, and that's a starting point of building a community, a beloved community, is that we're more intentional, even with people across the, I hate to say across the aisle, but that's the wrong metaphor these days. But, you know, yeah, just at the end of the pew, is that the other?
I think we're all the other. Each one of us is the other to the other. Mm-hmm. So listening's important. We learn when we listen, and we are gratified when we're heard.
I think Barbara Linda Key has her hand up.
Oh, yes, I see now.
I was a teacher for a long time, and for world history, and one of my assignments was for my students to go out and meet the other and put themselves in a position to enjoy other cultures and other things. So through visiting restaurants or dances or concerts. And so one of the things that Shirley and my cousin Liz and I last year did was take advantage of all the churches that are having fish fries on Friday for the next 6 weeks. And I get the enchiladas from Our Lady of Guadalupe are excellent. And there's Amy, the Holy Marin, Holy Family, I think is Orthodox, Lebanese Orthodox Church from over on the west side. They have a Friday meal, and this is a way for us to be brave, to go someplace different, to meet our neighbors in their space, and it's not a penalty. It's a delight. It's a way to do something fun that's not a chore, but enjoyable, and something we can all do for the next 6 weeks during Lent. And it tastes good.
Jared and then Jay, I think, Jared.
Yeah, I love that question, Barbara. Who is the other? And it makes me too want to ask, I think another question that can echo that is what is missing in the space, or who is missing in the space? And I think, you know, I was sitting with a group of colleagues this weekend, and we all went to different seminaries, and I was struck as they described the curricula and the way in which each of their schools approached formation, that I was remembering how we were empty vessels at General Seminary to be filled with the knowledge of the establishment and the Orthodox way of doing things. And my friends who had gone to Union Seminary were sent there to question everything and to always doubt, you know, what was being said, and to sort of fully interrogate it. And my friends who had gone to Episcopal Divinity School were told that every class began with a power analysis of the material being presented. Where is the power in it? And I think in my life, I've been lucky enough to have been really actually other in spaces. I was a missionary in Taiwan where I was definitely the minority. I lived in a native village and went to high school where I was definitely the minority population. But one of the things I never appreciated until I got older was that in those spaces as a white, straight American male, I still had power, often even more power than those who were in the majority. And so I think other is a good question to ask, who is other? But I also think it's important to ask, where's the power and who's missing? And to hold those questions in front of us as well, in any space that we're in as church.
Thanks, Jared. Jay, you had your hand up.
Yeah, and again, I don't know whether I mentioned this before. I know I talked with Jared and Craig about it, but one of the things we did at North Park when I was there is we had what we called our Mosaic program. And we would take a weekend, and given Chicago was the way it was, we would visit with various ethnic groups and communities over the weekend. We went to the Japanese American Center and talked to two women who had been interned. They were elderly Japanese women. We went to a Native American Center. It's a very large Native community in Chicago. We went to two or three different Hispanic communities because there are multiple Hispanic communities in Chicago. And we talked to them about the issues facing their community. We ate their food. We spent a good deal of time with a couple of different African-American communities, including sleeping in sleeping bags in the basement of an African-American church. And ended up at DeSavo Museum of African American History in Chicago. And you know, that would not be hard to do in Minneapolis. Mm-hmm. Places of pilgrimage to which we could go with a variety of ethnicities and foods and experiences and places where tragedies occurred, where good things happened. You know, our community has that kind of opportunity as well. So I think discovering and developing an awareness of who we have in our own community and our own community history is one of our ways to move into it, that question of who is the other and how are we other to them, which is another part of the question. I just offer that as a thought as to how, as a congregation, we could do some of these things with our youth, with families, and introduce them to parts of Minneapolis, St. Paul, and the region that they may not know about or have ever experienced.
Thanks, Jay. There's refer to the chat. Sounds like there's an opportunity to reach out and discover other, you know, a lot of this conversation, Craig, maybe as you and Jared think about this questionnaire, there's a lot of ideas about reaching out, these connection points that maybe instead of, I think they're going to kind of fall on the floor of this room. Maybe there's an opening in your survey where these ideas of connecting to other are captured instead of these wonderful thoughts, you know, being ejected here, which are yes, and then we run out the door and life happens and that we haven't captured it. So
to that point, Don, so the staff have been discussing this book a week after you. We listen to the recording of these forums, and then as a staff, we kind of try and have our own discussion to think about, well, as people call to equip parishioners of this church, what are we hearing in these conversations that we can then apply in praxis? So yes, that's going to definitely be part of how we formulate these questions and how we really have collective wisdom here at St. John's that I think we can listen to and share. And then to this other point of other, I've been reading Willie James Jennings, who is a theologian, and he talks about a pedagogy of belonging that in Western European Anglo-North Atlantic culture, we've been trained to not belong. We've been trained to be self-sufficient. And I think what this book and what the church and what Christ himself calls us to is a culture of love and belonging. And I think it has to start, like you said, Don, with the person next to you in the pew.
Yeah.
And if it hasn't started there, if you haven't cultivated a pedagogy of love and belonging, there's no way that you're going to be able to invite people into that culture who are very different to who you are. So I think we can concretely do that. And I think there's, again, there's lovely resources in this text that we can, in very small but very powerful fractals. Adrienne Marie Brown talks about this in the Emergent Strategy book. Small fractals, powerful small fractals like starlings start moving in the same direction, or fish move in the same direction, when one has the courage to do something countercultural, something loving, something unexpected, something creative. Now the bells are ringing, so I have to go. Mm. But
yeah, your comment about self-sufficiency, that was part of one of our conversations as well, that it's self-sufficiency is a deficiency, as
Jennings has been saying.
It's called After Whiteness.
Yeah. Okay.
Roger, and then how about Barbara then?
In all of these discussions, many seem to kind of be organizational. Yet discipleship is key in her title for the chapter. Mm-hmm. And so there seems to be, to me, lacking that, not so much top down, but how are we able to form, as she would say, really be disciples of Jesus? How do we form under sort of somebody who can mentor, teach, lead to these experiences? And so it isn't just what does a big group do, but how do we have that small, where actual discipleship can happen, where we can experience and fail and to succeed? So there's a component to it that I don't hear very strong in the discussion about what really is discipleship.
Yeah, I agree, Roger, because we're not gonna move forward with just field trips. You know, we're gonna move forward with that and, you know, this practice, this disciple practice. Barbara.
I'll leave in a minute, but in the responses I got to the blog I put out on Friday about, I don't know how many of you read it, but about the exhaustion that we may feel with Ukraine now taking such intensity, almost replacing COVID.
Yeah.
I think I got a lot of responses to that on emails, all to the effect of, I just feel so beaten up right now. I don't know if I can even come to church.
Right.
I mean, I don't think we should underestimate the degree of exhaustion and kind of energylessness that is in among us. And I think that might be a prerequisite for starting, you know, as you said, the person at the end of the pew.
Yeah.
We do it individually or it's with a plan, but it's really out there. I was amazed.
Yeah. And I said, there's going to be many disruptions in our community and in this parish.
Yeah.
That only practice is going to be there. Other thoughts from the screen or from the room?
Yeah, I just want to say real quick, Don, that point that Barbara makes, I think, is probably one of the most important to hear. And I think it takes me back again to what the bishop was trying to say to us clergy this week, because we feel that too, that exhaustion of not being up to the task of just facing the multiplicity of needs right now in the world. And I think to Roger's point, I do think if our faith formations focus on a year of the way of love did nothing, it was point to the substance of a discipleship that reaches into every component of those seven practices or seven habits of learning, turning, growing, praying, worshiping, serving, you know, those real concrete things that we need.
Thing, Jared.
Yes. and rest. And rest. Yeah. But that those do require us to take those concrete steps. And I think that's where the discipleship is in those habits, in those practices that need to be ensconced in an individual and then a collective way of life, or a rule of life, to use the monastic term, that we, particularly as Episcopalians, are often a little bit flaccid on. We're not very robust in building a habit of connected practices. We're lucky if we have one or two. And the bishop said it this week, if you're not praying, we're not going to get through this. You know, like, we're not going to be able to do it. And starting there, I think, is really helpful.
Thanks, Jared. I see Amy has her hand up.
I apologize. I didn't get the name of the gentleman who was at the other end of the couch from Barbara. But to your question about how you do this, you guys have the skills, man. I'm a former member of the church. I grew up there, but I'm other. And I started as a lurker for the morning prayer service. And it's only because somebody reached out to me and said, oh my gosh, is this Marvin Sue's daughter, that I then became part of the actual community and started going to coffee hour and joining online with the camera for morning prayer. So you guys are really, really good at talking to people. And then because I was posting it on my page, a friend of mine who is Lutheran came, and everybody just embraced him. Now, we look like you guys, so that makes it a little easier. But if you just take those skills and that welcoming that you have and go out of your comfort zone to meet people, but be just as welcoming and embracing as you are, that's how you do it. You guys got it.
Holly.
Yeah, I guess to follow up on, maybe this is Barbara's point, I'm not quite sure where it fits anymore, but the fact that not only are we kind of worn out, but I think we have to remember that in reaching out and being beloved community, we have to be able to figure out community again. I mean, I think we're just taking baby steps now. We're coming out of a pandemic. We're taking our masks off here for the first time in a long time. I haven't seen some of your faces in years, you know, or I've seen them on the screen, and Amy says, and you guys, and so is it you guys here, you know, in the fireside room or the ones on the screen? I mean, I'm not even sure what beloved community means sometimes for, and to reach out and decide what discipleship is in this context, and who's other. I sometimes feel like other, and I'm sitting right here in the church. So I don't know, you know, it's not a small next step that we're taking from a pretty big disruption that we've had in this community for the past couple of years.
You know, as you were typing, Holly, I was remembering Barbara always mentions, several times brings the story of, what if the stars only came out once every 100 years? You heard her inject that. What would that day be like? And I think, yes, we're not going to be able to just turn things back on, but we are going to have these moments of extreme joy where we see the stars for the first time in 100 years. You know, that's what I'm looking forward to, are, you know, public hugs and, you know, those kinds of things that we've missed for 2 years now. I guess I would just also just want to get back to this sort of, like Roger said, organizational tactical things versus our own practice or rule, that we are also encouraged through this book to be following. So it's not just, well, the church needs to do these things differently and have, popcorn night or whatever it is, or movie night, but there's this practice that really we'd have to walk into that room with, that would make us open and more connected as disciples. So it's not a or, it's an and of our individual practice. And I think that's what I see in these measures. And then everyone trying to, let's solve the problem. Let's do this and that. I, we could get caught up in that without, but we need to make sure that we draw back on that practice. Yes, Otto.
Yeah, I was gonna say, Holly just brought up, and Barbara too, can we reconnect as a community and reach out at the same time?
And yeah. Is that possible? 2 years now, we have not been, no, I love it. And then, and also, I think another.
Because we lost people along the way, and have we forgotten those people? Have they drifted away? Can we bring people back? Mm-hmm. Are they suffering and we don't know because we don't see them? I mean, there's a lot of reconnection, reassessing that could be done. So we make sure people feel like, hey, maybe we did, we have to be honest, maybe we did forget about you because we haven't seen you, we haven't seen each other, and we're so sorry, but please, you know, in our hearts, you're still there. I'm sorry that we left, because there are a lot of people I think about that I haven't seen in 2 years, but I haven't seen them virtually or in person. I just haven't seen them.
Well, that's permeated up, bundled up in this room. I remember Barbara's comment a few several weeks ago. It's like, you don't know how hard this is.
Yeah.
And I go home and my wife and, kids who've been there, there have been some people who are not only exhausted, but have had 2 years of virtually complete absence of connectivity.
Right.
And we're humans. We need it. So I can see you're... I think the end of the pew is going to be where our first mission is. Oh, I'm sorry. There's Phil. Phil?
Yeah, I was going to say, why can't we do both at once? In other words, in reconnecting, why aren't we, in fact, being disciples? That's part of discipleship, is going out and reconnecting may be the first part of that action, or that that fact of being disciples. I don't see these as necessarily opposite or separate activities.
All right. Well, we are reaching our time here for us to transition. Are there any other final thoughts? Otherwise, I'll close with a prayer. I saw that Amy was hearting those last couple of comments. Thanks, Amy. Loving, I guess.
Well, thank you to whoever picked the book. I think it was really good for us to discuss.
Yeah, I had my concerns when Mark and I briefly chat about this at men's group. We're going to go up through this right now. But I think it's because of who we are.
Right.
We've been able to walk through it with a healthy, listening to each other. So I'm going to just close. I want to close with the second verse of hymn 583. And I didn't know where this conversation was going to go, but I love this as our closing prayer. Let us pray. Oh, shame to us who rest content while lust and greed for gain, in street and shop and tenement, wring gold from human pain. And bitter lips in blind despair cry, Christ has died in vain. Give us, O God, the strength to build the city that has stood too long a dream, whose laws are love, whose crown is servanthood, and where the sun that shineth is God's grace, for human good. Amen.
Thank you,
Doc. Thank you.
Thank you.